In section 3.4, we will continue talking about contingency tables. This contingency table we were introduced to in section 3.1. So let's take a look at part A. If two of the 1,000 test subjects are randomly selected, find the probability that they both had false positive results. What is a false positive? Well, false positive, it means that the subject got a positive test result, but the subject is not a drug user, which is why it's a false result. So this is a false positive result. Now we're selecting two subjects. Okay, we got the first subject and we got the second subject. So what is the probability that the first subject got a false positive? Remember, probability is the number of false positives, which we have 90 subjects who got a false positive, divided by the total number, which is 1,000. So out of the 1,000, the probability that one of them got a false positive is 90 over 1,000. Now, once we take that one subject out, the total number of subject reduces to 999, because we had 1,000, we take out one subject. Out of the false positives, we had 90 people, 90 subjects who got a false positive, but once we take one of those out, we now only have 89 subjects who got a false positive. So the probability that they both had false positives is 90 over 1,000 times 89 over 999. If you multiply this, we would get 0.00802. Part B, find the probability that two randomly selected subjects both have a negative test result. Okay, now we're looking at negative test results. So how many people got a negative test result? We had 6 plus 860. We had a total of 866 people who got our negative test results. We're looking at two subjects. So we got the first subject and we got the second subject. What is the probability that the first subject got a negative test result? Well, how many total people got a negative test result? 866. And the total number of subjects was 1,000. But once we take out one person who got a negative test result, now we only have 865 people who got a negative test result, and the total number of subjects is now at 999. If you multiply these together, this is going to be equal to 0.750. So if you take out two people at random, there's a 0.75 probability that they both got a negative test result. And this probability is fairly high because you have a lot of people who got a negative test result. Part C, find the probability that a randomly selected person has a positive test result given, this is the key word here, that they're not a drug user. Okay, so let's revisit the conditional probability. The probability of event B occurring given that event A has already occurred is the probability of A and B over the probability of A. So our total is now limited to the probability of A. Why? Because we assumed that A has already occurred. So let's look at the condition. Find the probability selected person has a positive test result given that they are not a drug user. So how many people are not drug users? So if you look at subject not a drug user, there are 950 people who are not drug users. So that's already given, that's already occurred. So we're only drawing from the pool of these 950 individuals because we already assume that they're not a drug user. Now find the probability that a randomly selected person has a positive test result. So how many subjects have a positive test result given that they are not a drug user? So we're only looking at this row here, because we're assuming that they're not a drug user. So we can only focus on the second row where the subject is not a drug user. So given that they're not a drug user, how many of them had a positive result? Well, 90 of them. So we have 90 over 950, which is 0.0947. So if we only focus on individuals who are not drug users, they're 950 total, how many of them got a positive drug result? It's going to be 90. So it's 90 over 950, which is 0.0947. Okay, the second one, please try by yourselves, and we will go over this in class. Now, let's look at the 5% rule for independence. If you're sampling without replacement, so for example, if I have 1,000 people and I'm selecting two people at random, that means I'm not replacing the individual, so that's without replacement, and your sample size is less than 5% of the population, then you can pretend you're sampling with replacement and that each trial is independent. Because the effect on probability is small enough that we just don't care.